हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई एम निशा शर्मा, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इंग्लिश. द टॉपिक अंडर डिस्कशन टुडे इज अ क्रिटिकल एनालिसिस ऑफ विलियम शेक्सपियर सोनेट नॉट मार्बल नॉर द गिल्डेड मॉन्यूमेंट्स. विलियम शेक्सपियर वॉज एन इंग्लिश पोएट, प्ले राइट एंड एक्टर, वाइडली रिगार्डेड एज द ग्रेटेस्ट राइटर इन द इंग्लिश लैंग्वेज एंड द वर्ल्ड ग्रेटेस्ट ड्रामेटिस्ट. He is considered as the father of English literature. Sometime between 1585 and 1592, he began a successful career in London as an actor, writer, and part owner of a playing company called the Lord Chamberlain's Men, later known as the King Men. He appears to have retired to Stratford around 1613 at the age of 49, where he died after 3 years. He is often called England's national poet. Shakespeare produced most of his non-work between 1589 and 1613. His early plays were primarily comedies and histories. Some of his famous tragic plays include Hamlet, Macbeth, King Lear, and Othello. The 154 sonnets he has left behind him were composed at intervals in moments snatched from his dramatic work. One of the problems of Shakespeare's sonnets is the problem of their arrangement. Most critics, however, agree that Shakespeare's sonnets consist of two groups of poems, a long series addressed to the fair youth, sonnet 1 to 126, followed by a shorter series concerned with the dark lady, sonnet 127 to 154. We have already done a stanza-wise analysis of Not Marble, Not the Gilded Monuments. Today, we'll make its a critical appreciation of the poem. Not Marble, Not the Gilded Monument is the 55th sonnet written by William Shakespeare. It tells about the limitations of worldly glory and grandeur. All the great monuments, memorials, and sonnet 55 is interpreted as a poem in part about time and immortalization. The poet claims that his poem will outlast palaces and cities, great monuments and memorials, and keep the young man's good qualities alive until the last judgment. The sonnet traces the progression of time from the physical endeavors built by men, monuments, statues, masonry, as well as the primal notion of warfare depicted through the image of Mars, his sword, and war's quick fire, to the concept of the last judgment. The young man will survive all of these things through the verses of the speaker. The statues erected by princes, rulers, and the rich to perpetuate their memory are subject to decay, destruction, and deterioration. The ravages of time and the agents of destruction destroy and damage all such monuments and memorials. Only the powerful rhyme of the poet and great poetry will survive the ravages of time. Through the written words of this poem, the poet will immortalize the memory of his friend till the day of his last judgment. John Crow Ransom points out that there is a certain self-refuting aspect to the promises of immortality. For all the talk of causing the subject of the poems to live forever, the sonnets keep the young man mostly hidden. The claim that the poems will cause him to live eternally seem odd when the vocabulary used to describe the young man is so vague with words such as lovely, sweet, beauteous, and fair. In this poem, among the memorable descriptions of ruined monuments, the reader only gets a glimpse of the young man in line 10. Pacing forth, these monuments, statues, and masonry reference both Horace Ode and Ovid's Metamorphoses. Lars Engel argues that echoing the ancients, as the speaker does when he says, "Not marble, nor the gilded monuments of princes shall outlive this powerful rhyme," further solidifies the speaker's claim about the longevity of the written word. However, while Horace and Ovid claim the immortality for themselves, The speaker in Sonnet 55 bestows it on another. Inger also claims that this is not the first time Shakespeare references the self-aggrandizement of royals and rulers by saying that poetry will outlive them. He frequently mentions his own unimportance, which could lead Sonnet 55 to be read as a sort of revenge of the socially humble on their oppressor. While the first quatrain is referential and full of a misery, in the second quatrain, Ernest Fontana focuses on the epithet sluttish time. The Oxford English Dictionary gives sluttish two definitions: dirty, careless, slovenly, which can refer to objects and persons of both sexes, and second, lewd, morally loose, and boorish. According to Fontana, Shakespeare intended the second meaning, personifying and assigning gender to time, making the difference between the young man's sonnets and the dark lady sonnets all the more obvious. She begins by addressing the grand marble and gilded statues and monuments. These are called this way when the speaker compares them to the verse immortalizing the beloved. However, when compared to sluttish time, they are unswept stone besmear. The same technique occurs in the second quatrain. Battle occurs between mortal monuments of princes. Conflict is crude and vulgar. Wasteful war overturns unelaborated statues and broils throughout masonry. Later in quatrain, war becomes war's quickfire and broils become Mars' sword. The war is suddenly grand and the foes are emboldened. The blatant contempt with which the speaker regards anything not having to do with the young man or anything that works against the young man's immortality raises the adoration of the young man by contrast alone. According to the poet, be it grand monuments or great statues, all will be destroyed by time. Built around Horace's idea of poetry outliving physical monument, Shakespeare wishes to erect an everlasting monument for his beloved. In other words, his poetic offering. He wishes to immortalize his beloved through his words, a way he believes will stand the test of time. This figurative monument of praise and love for his fair lord will live on even after the poet and his beloved have departed the world. He personifies time by using sluttish as an epithet to qualify it. He describes time as an immoral woman, perhaps drawing comparisons in terms of unfaithfulness. Time is, after all, unfaithful. It leaves one side. It is never stationary. It is in constant flux and is ever changing. The word sluttish may also suggest the temporality of beauty or the facade of beauty that an immoral woman puts on. Just as the beauty of a slut is considered an entrapment, likewise, time and its favorable aspects are considered fatal snares. The poet moves on to an associated theme next, where he suggests the possibility of an impending disaster to hit humanity. It may so happen that even before time, an untimely disaster like war may pull down monuments and raise the statues to the ground. If the monument stood for glory, they would be robbed of it all. The oblique reference to the transience of all other artwork, masonry, is unmistakable here. However, even wars cannot destroy the power of the written word. The irony lies in the fact that poetry written on paper, which is perishable, has the power to outlive stone and marble monuments. Note the uses of wasteful to describe wars, which shows the poet's attitude of lamenting wars. It reflects the poet's attitude to war, which he considers a waste of life and resources. It is a dark force of destruction and animosity. The reference to Mars, his sword, points towards the Greek mythology, where Mars is the god of war. It is noteworthy that the poet believes that his work of art will remain untouched by the fires of war. Shakespeare seems to have been rather futuristic in that aspect. Since generations have passed and we are still reading his works and indeed getting to discover the fair lord. There have been many speculation regarding the identity of the fair youth or fair lord, but the most commonly accepted reference is that of the Henry Wriothesley, the third Earl of Southampton. In Sonnet 3, he claims the fair youth to be his mother's mirror image. Time and its ravages on youth and beauty is a recurring theme in Shakespeare's sonnet. Here, he moves a step further and focuses on the accomplices of time, such as wasteful war, broils, Mars's sword, war's quick fire, and so on to describe time's destructive nature. This sonnet number 55 has been very popular. It is similar to other sonnets written by Shakespeare. It was first published in 1609. The poem speaks about the immortality of words. Nothing can outshine the power and charm of words. It also illustrates how the speaker is proud of his immortal word. Thus, the sonnet is as a representative of pride. The speaker adores the beauty and unrestricted nature of his work. He compares his work with dead rich kings and argues that everything has a lifespan, but his words are immortal that will outlive everything in the universe. He reflects on the memory of his beloved friend and says that his friends will shine in these words forever. To him, kings and princes lived in an illusion, believing that they could preserve themselves in the form of monuments. Unfortunately, devastating wars overturned statues and conflicts during the Masons' handiwork. Since his friend is preserved in the form of words, therefore he will not face a fall. Even after his death, his memory will never fade into the oblivion. He will continue to win praise in the face of successive generations that will enjoy this poetic piece. What, however, stays in the minds of the readers is his matchless love for his friend. Yet on a secondary level, we do not read the poem in that way at all, for we are well aware that the words survive far longer than any memory of the youth, whose face and name we do not even know. The striking images of crumbling stone and violent war etch themselves into our minds, and in the midst of this waste and decay, we realize that if anything will survive, it will be the poet's words, and both he and the loved one will be swept away into oblivion. Immortality of sorts is thus achieved for the poem, but for nothing else unless it be for the love which dwells in lover's eyes. Sonnet 55 is interpreted as a poem in part about time and immortalization. The poet claims that his poem will outlast palaces and cities and keep the young man's good qualities alive until the last judgment. The sonnet traces the progression of time from the physical endeavors built by men, as well as the primal notion of warfare depicted through the image of Mars's sword, war's quick fire, to the concept of last judgment. The young man will survive all of these things through the verses of the speaker. Now, the themes of the sonnet. Sonnet number 55 is a famous sonnet which rings changes on the theme celebrated by Horace. Horace's translation of Horace's line is, "I have built a monument more lasting than bronze," but here given a new meaning in that it is the loved one who is immortalized rather than the poet. The poet is himself only the instrument to accomplish this end, and he humbly celebrates the glory of youth. The sonnet shares its theme with that of several others like 18, 19, 65, 81, 107, and 123 number of sonnet, which oppose the power of words to death and time's cruel knife and promise immortality to the beloved. Curiously enough, it does not seem to make any difference that the verse immortalizes the youth without revealing him, for the very fact of immortality seems to confer anonymity. The concluding couplet seems to be entirely satisfying, and we do not need to press further inquiries on the poet and demand to know who it is to whom eternal life is given. It is enough that he lives in lovers' eyes, for they comprehend all mysteries, and perhaps on the last day at the ending room, we will know all the answers anyway and realize that they were not at all that important. Thus, the sonnet deals with the unique theme of immortality through verse. In this sonnet, the bard talks about the futility of worldly glory and material attempts at immortalization. He refers to princes, great rulers, and the rich who have sought to immortalize themselves or what they love through monuments, statues, and memorials. He believes not marble nor the gilded monuments can stand the ravages of time. If there is anything that can immortalize a person, a memory, or an object of love, it is poetry. Another theme is the theme of love. In the next few lines, he goes on to say that even after his beloved is dead, praises for him shall find a place in history, and that way he will be remembered again and again for generations to come. Neither death nor the life's enmities will ever be able to tarnish or fade his glory. The reference to posterity suggests that even though the poet loved his beloved dearly, he was not averse to the idea of him procreating with his wife. The judgment that yourself arise refers to the judgment day in the kingdom of God when he sits to run cases on souls. The poet contradicts himself when he says that after the day of judgment, there remains no need for immortality anymore. It might be interesting to speculate that he considers his fair lord to be a pure soul who will never be blackened on the day of judgment and thus will forever remain immortalized through the verse the poet composes for him. The poet's lover is the personification of love. Not only does he suggest that his beloved will live on in his poetry, but also that his poetry will exemplify the beloved as a personification of love in generations to come. He personifies love, and as love, he will be found residing in the eyes of lover. Not marble nor the gilded monuments, love and immortality versus mortality are the notable themes in the poem. The poem presents the heartfelt burst of confidence as the poet possesses the power to preserve his friend's memory in his verse. He argues that everything in the world loses its charm and beauty, but nothing can destroy his friend's glory and charm. Undoubtedly, wars bring destruction on the face of the earth. Even the great statues and monuments give way before the deadly battles. Therefore, he prefers preserving the memory of his friends in his verse. In this way, his friend will remain green forever till the day of judgment. Now, we'll have a look at the literary devices used in sonnet number 55. The literary devices are used to give vital ideas to simple compositions. The writer uses them to bring richness and clarity in their text and help readers understand the writer's intentions, emotions, and feelings. Shakespeare has also used some literary devices to bring depth to his poem. The analysis of some of the literary devices used in this poem have been given below, like assonance. Assonance is the repetition of vowel sounds in the same line. For example, the sound I in you live in this and dwell in lover's eyes, and the sound of A when wasteful war shall statues overturn. Alliteration. Alliteration is the repetition of consonant sounds in the same line in quick succession, like the sound ash, you shall shine more bright in these contents, and the sound W when wasteful war shall statues overturn. Enzement. Enzement is defined as a thought in verse that does not come to an end at a line break. Instead, it continues in the next line. For example, not marble nor the gilded monuments of princes shall outlive this powerful rhyme. Imagery. Imagery is used to make readers perceive things involving their five senses. For example, nor Mars is sore, nor war's quick fire, not marble nor the gilded monument. Visual imagery is used in unswept stone, besmeared with sluttish time, as the reader can imagine statues which become ruins with the passage of time, And when wasteful war shell statues overturn and broils root out the work of masonry, as the reader can imagine the destruction caused by wars. Personification. Personification is to give human qualities to inanimate objects. Shakespeare has used this device at many places in the poem, such as when wasteful war shell statues overcome and broils root out the work of masonry. Besides these literary devices, some poetic devices have also been used in the sonnet, like couplet. There are two constructive lines of verse in a couplet, usually in the same meter and joined by rhyme. This sonnet ends with a couplet, which usually reveals the central idea of the poem. For example, so till the judgment that yourself arise, you live in this and dwell in lover's eyes. End rhyme. End rhyme is used to make the stanza melodious. Arise, eyes, rhyme, time, room, doom. Iambic pentameter. It is a type of meter having five iambs per line. The poem follows iambic pentameter, for example, in so till the judgment that yourself arise. The rhyme scheme of the poem is AB, AB, CD, CD, EF, EF, GG. And the poem is a sonnet. It is a 14-line poem, usually written in iambic pentameter. This is a Shakespearean sonnet, which consists of three quatrains and a couplet. And there are three, the structure is three quatrain followed by a final rhyming couplet. Thank you.